Nights with Uncle Remus by Joel Chandler Harris. Chapter 70. Brer Rabbit Rescues Brer Tarrapin. The arrival of the Negroes from the river place added greatly to the enthusiasm with which the Christmas holidays were anticipated on the home place, and the air was filled with laughter day and night. Uncle Remus appeared to be very busy, though there was really nothing to be done except to walk around and scold at everybody and everything, in a good-humored way, and this the old man could do to perfection. The night before Christmas Eve, however, the little boy saw a light in Uncle Remus's cabin, and he interpreted it as in some sort a signal of invitation. He found the old man sitting by the fire and talking to himself.
"If Mars John and Miss Sally expects me fur to keep all dese yer niggers straight, dey're gwine to be disappointed, dat dey is. If dey was 11 em Remuses, 'twouldn't make no difference, let 'long one po' old cripple creature like me. Dey ain't done no damage yit, but I bound ye by tomorrow night they'll turn loose and turn the whole place upside down and tear it up by the roots. And then after it's all done gone and done, yer'll come Miss Sally a-layin' it all at old Remus's door. Nigger ain't got much chance in dese yer low grounds, mo' especially when dey gets old and crippled like I is."
"What are they going to do tomorrow night, Uncle Remus?" the little boy inquired.
"Now what make you ax dat, honey?" exclaimed the old man in a grieved tone. "You knows mighty well how dey done last year and the year 'fore dat. Dey took and cut up around here wuss'n if dey was wild creatures, and tomorrow night there'll be a hollerin' and a whoopin' and singin' and dancin' 'fore it get dark good. I wish when you go up to the big house you'd be so good as to tell Miss Sally dat if she want any peace of mind she better get off'n the place and stay off twill after dese yer niggers get their fill of Christmas. Goodness knows she can't spec an old cripple nigger like me fur to catch hold and keep all dese yer niggers straight."
Uncle Remus would have kept up his vague complaints, but right in the midst of them Daddy Jack stuck his head in at the door and said,
"Hunna been fix dat 'Tildy gal shoe. Me come fur to get dem shoe. Me come fur to pay you for dem shoe."
Uncle Remus looked at the grinning old African in astonishment. Then suddenly the truth dawned upon him, and he broke into a loud laugh. Finally he said,
"Come in, Brer Jack. Come right long in. I'm sorta poorly myself, yet I'll make out to make you welcome. There was a quarter dollar gwine into my britches pocket on the count of dem air shoes, but if you're gwine to pay for 'em, it won't be but a sevenpence."
Somehow or other, Daddy Jack failed to relish Uncle Remus's tone and manner, and he replied, with some display of irritation,
"Shoo, me no come in no at all. Me no pay you sevenpence. Me come for pay you for dem shoe. Me come for to take 'em away from day-day."
"I don't know about dat, Brer Jack. I don't know about dat. De last time I year you and 'Tildy gwine on, she was upon de points of knocking your brains out. Now den, supposin' I whirls in and gids you de shoes, and den 'Tildy come 'long and ax me about 'em, what I gwine to say to 'Tildy?"
"Me pay you for dem shoe,"
said Daddy Jack, seeing the necessity of argument,
"and me take 'em way de little 'Tildy gal been stay. She tell me for come get at dem shoe."
"Well, den, here dey is,"
said Uncle Remus, sighing deeply as he handed Daddy Jack the shoes.
"Here dey is, and you're more than welcome, dat you is. But spite of dat, dish yer quarter you fliggin' way on 'em would have done you a sight more good than what dem shoes is."
This philosophy was altogether lost upon Daddy Jack, who took the shoes and shuffled out with a grunt of satisfaction. He had scarcely got out of hearing before 'Tildy pushed the door open and came in. She hesitated a moment, and then, seeing that Uncle Remus paid no attention to her, she sat down and picked at her fingers with an air quite in contrast to her usual uppishness,
as Uncle Remus called it.
"Uncle Remus,"
she said, after a while, in a subdued tone,
"is dat ole Affikin nigger been yere atter dem air shoes?"
"Yes, chile," replied Uncle Remus with a long-drawn sigh. "He done been yere and got 'em and gone. Yes, honey, he done got 'em and gone. Done come and pay for 'em and got 'em and gone. I says I, dat I wish you all mighty well, and he took and tucked the shoes and put. Yes, chile, he done got 'em and gone." Something in Uncle Remus's sympathetic and soothing tone seemed to exasperate Tildy. She dropped her hands in her lap, straightened herself up, and exclaimed,
"Yes, I is gwine to marry dat old nigger, and I don't care who knows it. Miss Sally says she don't care, and the other folks may care if they want her. In much good their caring will do 'em."
Tildy evidently expected Uncle Remus to make some characteristic comment, for she sat and watched him with her lips firmly pressed together and her eyelids half closed, an attitude of defiance significant enough when seen, but difficult to describe. But the old man made no response to the challenge. He seemed to be very busy. Presently, Tildy went on.
"Somebody bleeds to take care of that old nigger, and I don't know who'd gwine do it if I don't. Somebody bleeds to look after him. Good wind come long, it'd about blow him away if they want somebody close round for to take care of him. Let alone dat, I ain't going to have dat old nigger man forever internally trotting after me. I tell you de Lord's truth, Uncle Remus," continued Tildy, growing confidential. "I ain't had no peace of mind since that old nigger man come on dis place. He just been a pacing at my heels de whole blessed time, and I bleeds to marry him for to get rid of him."
"Well," said Uncle Remus, "it don't surprise me. You marry and den you're just like Brer Fox with his bag. You know what you put in it, but you don't know what you got in it."
Tildy flounced out without waiting for an explanation, but the mention of Brother Fox attracted the attention of the little boy, and he wanted to know what was in the bag, how it came to be there, and all about it.
"Now, Dan," said Uncle Remus, "it's a tale, and a mighty long tale at that, but I'll just have to cut it short, 'cause tomorrow night you'll want to be a settin' up and listenin' at the carryin's on of dem air niggers, which I believe in my soul they done lose all the sense they ever been borned with. One time, Brer Fox was gwine on down the big road, and he look ahead and he see old Brer Tarrypin making his way on towards home. Brer Fox 'lowed dis a mighty good time for to nab old Brer Tarrypin, and no sooner is he thunk it than he put out back home, which wa'n't but a little ways, and he get him a bag. He come back, he did, and he run up behind old Brer Tarrypin and flip him in de bag and sling de bag across his back and go galloping back home. Brer Tarrypin, he holler, but it ain't do no good. He rip and he roar, but it ain't do no good. Brer Fox just keep on a-gwoin', and it twa'n't long 'fore he had old Brer Tarrypin slung up in de corner in de bag, and de bag tied him hard and fast." "But whiles all dis goin' on," exclaimed Uncle Remus, employing the tone and manner of some country preacher he had heard, "where was old Brer Rabbit? Yes, sir, that's it. Where was he? And more'n dat, what you spec he is doin', and where you reckon he were goin'? Dat's de way to talk it. Whereabouts was he?"
The old man brought his right hand down upon his knee with a thump that jarred the tin plate and cups on the mantel shelf, and then looked around with a severe frown to see what the chairs and the workbench and the walls and the rafters had to say in response to his remarkable argument. He sat thus in a waiting attitude a moment, and then, finding that no response came from anything or anybody, his brow gradually cleared, and a smile of mingled pride and satisfaction spread over his face, as he continued in a more natural tone.
"You can believe me or not believe just as your mind to, but dat dere long-year creature, dat dere hoppity-skippity, dat dere up and down and sailin' round Brer Rabbit, which you been year me call his name fold is, he'd want so mighty fur off whiles Brer Fox goin' long wid dat dere bag slung across his back. Let alone dat, Brer Rabbit is sittin' right dere in de bushes by de side of de road, and whence he see Brer Fox go trottin' by, he ax himself, what is dat creature got in dat dere bag? He ax himself, he did, but he don't know. He wonder, and he wonder. Yet de more he wonder, de more he dunno. Brer Fox, he go trottin' by, and Brer Rabbit, he sot in de bushes and wonder. By-and-by, he 'lowed to hisself, he did, that Brer Fox ain't got no business fur to be trottin' long down de road, totin' doin's what other folks don't know what they is. And he 'lowed that there won't be no great harm done if he can take out to Brer Fox and find out what he got in dat dere bag. Wid dat, Brer Rabbit, he put out. He ain't got no bag fur to tote, and he picks up his foots mighty pert. More than dat, he took and tuck a nigh cut, and by the time Brer Fox get home, Brer Rabbit done had time fur to go round by the watermelon patch and do some of his devilment, and then after dat he took and sot down in the bushes where he can see Brer Fox when he come home. By and by, here come Brer Fox with the bag slung across his back. He unlatched the door, he did, and he go in and sling Brer Tarrypin down in the corner and set down front of the hearth for to rest himself.
Here Uncle Remus paused to laugh in anticipation of what was to follow.
Brer Fox ain't more'n lit his pipe,
the old man continued after a tantalizing pause,
for Brer Rabbit stick his head in de door and holler,
"Brer Fox! Oh, Brer Fox! You better take your walking cane and run down yonder. Coming along just now, I hear a mighty fuss, and I look round and there is a whole passel of folks in your watermelon patch just a-tromplin' round and tearing down. I hollered at 'em, but they ain't paid no attention to little man like I is. Make haste, Brer Fox, make haste. Get your cane and run down there. I'd go wid you myself, but my old woman ailin', and I bleeds to be making my way towards home. You better make haste, Brer Fox, if you want to get the good of your watermelons. Run, Brer Fox, run!"
Wid dat, Brer Rabbit dart back in de bushes, and Brer Fox drap his pipe and grab his walking cane and put out fur his watermelon patch, which were down on de branch. And no sooner is he gone than old Brer Rabbit come out of de bushes and make his way in de house. He goes so easy that he ain't make no fuss. He look round and dere was de bag in de corner. He cotch hold of de bag and sort of feel of it. And time he do this, he hears something holler,
"Ow! Go away! Let me alone! Turn me loose! Ow!"
Brer Rabbit jump back astonished. Den, fore you can wink your eyeball, Brer Rabbit slap hisself on de leg and break out in a laugh. Den he up and allow,
"If I ain't make no mistakes, dat dere kind of fuss can come from nobody in de round world but old Brer Tarrypin."
Brer Tarrypin, he holler, says he,
"Ain't dat Brer Rabbit?"
"De same," says he.
"Den whirl in and turn me out. Meal dust in my throat, grit in my eye, and I ain't can get my breath scarcely. Turn me out, Brer Rabbit."
Brer Tarrypin talk like somebody down in a well. Brer Rabbit, he holler back,
"You're a lot smarter than what I is, Brer Tarrypin. Lot smarter. You're smarter and perter. Pert as I come here, you is ahead of me. I know how you get in de bag, but I don't know how in de name of goodness you tie yourself up in dere. Dat I don't."
Brer Tarrypin tried to explain, but Brer Rabbit keep on laughing. He laughed till he get his fill of laughing, and then he took and untied the bag and take Brer Tarrypin out and towed him away off in de woods. Den,
When he done dis, Brer Rabbit took and run off and get a great big hornet nest, what he see when he coming along.
"A hornet's nest, Uncle Remus?" exclaimed the little boy in amazement.
"To be sure, honey. 'Tain't been a month since I brung you a great big hornet nest, and here you is axin' that. Brer Rabbit took and slap his hand across the little hole where the hornets goes in at, and dare he had 'em. Den he took and tuck it to Brer Fox house, and put it in the bag where Brer Terrapin been. He put the hornet nest in there," continued Uncle Remus, lowering his voice and becoming very grave, "and den he tie up the bag just like he find it. Yet 'fore he put the bag back in the corner, what do dat creature do? 'I ain't sitting here,' said the old man, seizing his chair with both hands, as if by that means to emphasize the illustration. 'I ain't sitting here if dat dare creature ain't grab dat bag and slam it down agin de floor, and hit it agin de side of de house twill he got dem dare hornets all stirred up. And den he put de bag back in de corner, and he go out in de bushes to where Brer Terrapin waitin', and den both of 'em sot out dare and wait for to see what de upshot gwine to be. Bimeby, here come Brer Fox back from his watermelon patch, and he look like he mighty mad. He strike his cane down 'pon de ground, and do like he gwine take his revengeance out of poor old Brer Terrapin. He went in de door, Brer Fox did, and shot it after him. Brer Rabbit and Brer Terrapin listen, but they ain't year nothing. But bimeby, first news you know, dey year de most owdacious racket, to be sure. Seem like, from where Brer Rabbit and Brer Terrapin settin', that dey is a whole passel of cows runnin' round in Brer Fox house. Dey year de cheers a fallin', and de table turnin' over, and de crockery breakin', and den de door flewed open, out comes Brer Fox squallin' like de old man was after him. In such a sight as dem dare creatures seed, and dare ain't never been seed before nor since. Dem air hornets just swarmed on top of Brer Fox. 11 dozen of 'em had hit him at one time, and look like dat dare creature bleeds to find out for hisself what pain and suffering is. Dey bit him and dey stung him, and fur as Brer Rabbit and Brer Terrapin can year him, dem hornets just a-nailin' him. Gentlemen's, dey gun him binger. Brer Rabbit and Brer Terrapin, dey sot dare, dey did, and dey laugh and laugh, twel by and by, Brer Rabbit roll over and grab his stomach and holler,
'Don't, Brer Terrapin, don't! One giggle more and you'll have to tote me!'
"And dat ain't all," said Uncle Remus, raising his voice. "I know a little chap which if he sit up here disputin' longer me and de other creatures, he won't have much fun tomorrow night." The hint was sufficient, and the little boy ran out, laughing. End of chapter 70.